So, here we are. Welcome to Berkeley Place in Staunton. I wanted to talk to you about a program that I particularly liked that we did last summer, where the first entire half was dedicated to fugues from quite a few different centuries. And before I tell you more about the program, let's listen a little bit to just the first piece on the program. This is the beginning of Glenn Gould's very hilarious, slightly silly, but also brilliant, So You Want to Write a Fugue.
So you want to write a fugue, you've got the urge to write a fugue, you've got the nerve to write a fugue, so go on.
So you want to write a fugue,
you've got the urge to write a fugue,
you've got the nerve to write a fugue,
so
go on.
So I think you, even from the beginning, you get a real sense of this piece. It's hilarious. Of course, what it really is, especially in our version, it's sort of an instructional video of how to write a fugue. Because as the singers are telling you what they're doing and how you should write a fugue, they're actually making a fugue, which is pretty funny. There is another really remarkable moment here. You notice that this fugue starts with one subject. So you want to write a fugue. That theme later gets combined with a second theme, and the text is never be clever for the sake of being clever. The reason why this is so funny is because fugues are a kind of virtuoso vehicle for composers to show off their compositional techniques. And of course, just as he's saying, never be clever, he's being incredibly clever, because it's difficult to combine these two themes, and he starts to do all kinds of funny things. So that was our pretty boisterous beginning of this program, and then we moved to a very, very different kind of a piece, which is really one of the masterpieces of all of fugue repertoire, which is the first contrapuntus from Bach's Art of the Fugue. As you can tell, this is a completely different emotional world. It is abstract, personal, meditative, somewhat intellectual, but also deeply grounded. And when Bach wrote these fugues at the end of his life, he actually prepared them for publication. And I think he really knew that he had distilled his art of fugue writing, for which he was very famous, down to the essence. The next piece is yet completely different, takes us to the early 20th century composer Ernst Toch. And the interesting thing here is that it's a speaking fugue, meaning it's for vocal quartet, but all the parts are spoken. And it's called Fugue from the Geography because the text is made up of geographical names and terms. And yet it's a very clearly structured fugue. Of course, what you're missing here are the pitches, meaning the melody is reduced to its rhythm, but it's very intelligible, because you have the text and he can help you, this can help you to follow the structure of the piece.
Trinidad and the big Mississippi and the town Honolulu and the lake Titicaca. The Popocatépetl is not in Canada, rather in Mexico, Mexico, Mexico.
Trinidad and the big Mississippi and the town Honolulu and the lake Titicaca. The Popocatépetl is not in Canada, rather in Mexico, Mexico, Mexico. Trinidad is not in Canada.
Trinidad and the big Mississippi and the town Honolulu and the lake Titicaca, the capital is not Canada, rather in Mexico, Mexico.
The next piece on the program was a French fugue by Maurice Ravel, and the French people have historically had a very different aesthetic attitude towards the fugue. In Germany, the fugue was very much an intellectual and often religiously tinted variety of composition. In France, it's more sensuous, for lack of a better word, as French music often tends to be. And Ravel, as a quintessentially French composer, makes good use of this tradition. So here it is much more about how the instruments interact, intertwine, and create colors and harmonies, rather than having a sort of distinct argument between the various lines. Takes us the furthest away in this program from what we expect a traditional fugue to be. And that is because Lou Harrison's work is a fugue for percussion quartet. And what he adds to the traditional structures and principles of a fugue is that he has a particular sense of the timbre and the quality, the sound quality of the instruments. And he makes that just as important as the themes of the fugue. I would have felt that this program would not have been complete without having one of the earlier pieces that we nowadays would recognize as a fugue. The fugue really sort of originates in the late Middle Ages, but came into fruition during the Renaissance. And here's a motet by Josquin de Pré, and it is very clearly a fugue, but you can hear the connection to religious music that the fugue had and still has from the very early ages. First half of this program with a work by a composer that most people do not associate with fugues, but he was an excellent technician. This is Piazzolla, the great tango composer. So here you have a piece where tango meets fugue. And in fact, it does make some sense, because a lot of the Baroque fugue music, the subjects for which, the melodies that those fugues use, are very much influenced by Baroque dances. So it's no surprise how well this piece works, having its roots in tango, which is also a dance, though not necessarily a Baroque dance. History. People often ask me, do you have a favorite program this summer? Any particular season, any given season, I get asked that question. And you never get an answer out of me. There are lots of programs I like, but I do have to say that I was very fond of the first half of this concert, the fugue portion.